The NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series had an eventful week off as we near the end of the 1999 championship chase. When we left Las Vegas Motor Speedway, Greg Biffle's gamble in the pits had paid off big time, culminating in a series record 9th victory and the first ever manufacturer's title for Ford. While those two milestones remain, much has changed in the Granger Ford garage. An unapproved part left the team $46,000 lighter in the pocket. But more critically, minus 120 valuable points, leaving the margin a mere 10 points over closest rival, Jack Sprague. Tonight, Biffle himself faces a new inspection. Can he shake off controversy? 4 times this year, Illumination has been Greg's invitation to victory lane. But if his bright light flickers, even a little, it could cost Roush Racing a shot at its first ever NASCAR championship. Biffle's light may have flickered a little bit already. Today in practice, he's done something that he has never done this year. He wrecked his primary truck. They went to the backup. They got it pretty good. They qualified 9th here tonight. But for Biffle, the key at Louisville is still going to be surviving this track.
Bent sheet metal is a rite of passage at Louisville Motor Speedway, but it's difficult to pass anyone on the Truck Series' smallest bullring. Avoiding contact may be the toughest task, as this track plays no favorites. Championship hopes could be demolished in an instant, and the points could shuffle as much as the field by the time this night grinds to a halt. And this afternoon, 6 trucks already have sheet metal damage, but one truck that came away with no mark was that of Jack Sprague. And if this is any race on the circuit that he needs to survive the most, it's now time. 10 points behind Biffle. Look for Jack Sprague to be out there tough with excitement here at Louisville.
Tonight, we're live from Louisville Motor Speedway for round 23 of 25 of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series. It's the Kroger 225. We have rain threatening off into the distance. The trucks are on the speedway taking the preliminary warm-up laps. Hello again, everybody. Marty Reed along with Benny Parsons. Here is our Mopar starting grid. Jimmy Hensley with his 4th career pole, first of the year. And then as you look on down the line, notice Jack Sprague, 3rd. And the rest of the points contenders, Benny, all grouped together.
Dennis Setzer starts back in 8th, the first time he's seen the racetrack. Greg Biffle in a backup truck, qualified 9th. And Stacy Compton in a backup is 10th.
Look at Ron Hornaday all the way back in 17th. And Mike Stefanik, big surprise there.
He was one of the fastest trucks in practice. He will start 21st. On a very difficult racetrack to pass on. Track position is the most important thing. Andy Houston's Cat Rental onboard camera. This is Dennis Setzer's Mopar Performance onboard camera in the front bumper. And Mike Wallace starting back in the 6th position, looking back at the back tailgate of his car as the trucks come off of the green.
Round 23 of 25 is underway at Louisville Motor Speedway. Hold on. This is getting very physical tonight. First time under the lights and leading the first lap is Jimmy Hensley. Mike Bliss on the outside, hanging on to second spot. Sprague trying to take a look underneath. 15 seconds a lap. That's what it'll take to go around this less than a half mile bull ring. Hensley leads lap number 2 of 225. And boy, Bliss able to hang on the outside, Benny. That's impressive.
That's exactly the word I was going to use. Very impressive. But now Hensley finally does clear it, and now he can't get down to the inside because Jack Sprague is there.
You know, Jimmy Hensley has the distinction of being the pole sitter at this event several years ago, back in 1997, when a guy by the name of Ron Hornaday took the lead on the very first lap, led it wire to wire. It was the only lead change that night. Hopefully that's not going to be the same here. Hensley still leading, though. It is Sprague in 3rd. Then in 4th, it is Joe Ruttman. Kevin Harvick rounds out the top 5. For more on the 43, Dave Burns.
Marty, just before Jimmy Hensley climbed into his red number 43, I asked him about strategy for the race. They know there's weather in the area. Jimmy said, at all costs, I'm going to get out front and stay out front. I'm going to use up my tires. I'm going to do whatever I have to do to head this field in case it rains.
Well, you notice on the graphic there, BP, he has done very well here at this racetrack.
He has an average finish, I think, of about a fourth place. But that means we probably will not see any pit stops until probably lap 110, 115, which is halfway of this race because of the weather that's in the area.
You're looking at the battle for 8th and 9th on board with Dennis Setzer and the Mopar Dodge. Right behind him, our points leader, Greg Biffle. If you were not with us on RPM, we told you earlier the points lead is down to 10 as a result of what happened after the post-race inspection. And then for the first time in Biffle's career this year, it looked like it was going to be a storybook year, but he crashed the primary truck. That is the backup. And he goes out with no practice, Benny, and put it 9th on the grid.
Put it in 9th spot, and he's running pretty doggone good. As we watch the field come by, there goes Biffle, and here goes Setzer.
Laps will fly by here. 113 makes this race official. It rained most of the morning. Finally got some activity onto the racetrack. Practice was a bit delayed, and then qualifying went for already into traffic. There goes Jimmy Hensley around the 46 of Rob Morgan.
And the 27 car, Robbie Thompson, also a lap down. Oh, he got a truck backed in the wall. The 17 truck of David Starr.
Starr backs it in and looks like he's going to get it underway. Still no yellow out. So Starr with damage on the rear of the John Conley Vitamist Chevrolet. And oh, another spinner now down into turn number one. And there goes our race leader right by him.
And this is going to bring out the caution flag because there is oil or water or something on the racetrack from Carl Long's truck. I think he's blown an oil line off or something. See the water up in front of the left front tire? So that moisture is on, that fluid is on the speedway.
So Long has damage on the right side. Look at the right front corner. Our first caution on lap number 14. And, well, you're right, Benny. There comes the steam. The record for cautions here in Louisville is 13. That's how physical this little half-mile bull ring, and it's actually under half a mile.
And you can see the fluid, the moisture on the speedway down in turn one, the shiny part right there.
And the guy's
about 15, 20 feet.
Take us through it, Benny. Here it comes.
We see Biffle and Setzer going by. And there we see the 17 of David Starr coming off the wall by the start-finish line. Does a pretty good job trying to save the vehicle. And this is the very back end of what happened to Carl Long.
And we have fluid all through turn one. Stay with us. We'll be back with more of the Kroger 225 under the lights here at Louisville Motor Speedway. We are under our first caution, and that is the reason why Carl Long in his third ever NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series race. His last time with us was at Bristol. He finished a respectable 20th, but it's not going to be that good tonight. Let's take another look and see what happened.
Going down in turn one, you see the smoke already. He's already made contact with the wall. And there you see the fluid, the smoke, fluid under the vehicle, and around the truck goes. He spins and drives the truck onto the pit area, but the damage was done. The fluid was put down that had NASCAR out on the racetrack, putting the oil dry down, something to soak up that fluid. And we can see the trucks now running through that, trying to clear the track of the oil dry.
Amy, let's get an update on that truck in second place. Mike Bliss.
Well, Mike Bliss is currently having radio trouble. And when I asked Matt Chambers what kind of trouble, he said when Mike hits the button to talk, he hears a beeping sound. And with two-way radios, when you hear that beeping, it means the battery is going dead. So Bliss is not going to talk so that he can continue to hear his spotter as he currently runs second. Dave Burns.
On the track, Stacy Compton was losing track position to Greg Biffle. Had about four truck lengths between he and Biffle the last time they were running green. So I went to Kevin Cram, asked him what was wrong with the truck. It's a little bit tight right now. They're waiting for air pressure to build, and they're also running third gear, not high gear right now. And Benny, a number of the teams told me today that because of the way the track is set up and the gearing here, they might just stick with third gear all night long.
Well, you have to run third gear basically here because you can't get enough gear rate. They don't make enough gear ratio for this racetrack by just simply putting in fourth gear, a 1-to-1. You need about a 7-to-1 final driver rear gear ratio. The highest thing they make is a 650. So you have to go through the transmission and use a different gear and use third gear to get the gear ratio that you need.
Jimmy Hensley leading this pack around the 30 truck field that started this race, been whittled to 29. Hensley is 72 points out of ninth place, 450 behind Greg Biffle in the championship chase. That's how tight the top 10 really is. And there is Mike Stefanik, and boy, he's been a guy on the move, BP.
We said at the very top of the show he started in 21st spot, one of the fastest trucks in practice. Well, he is showing that because he has moved up to the 14th position.
Dave, you got more?
Marty, he's passed some good trucks back there. So I asked Crew Chief Roland Wilatko what the story was. And Roland told me, he told Mike to save the tires. So I guess what that means is either Mike's not listening to his crew chief, which I don't think that's true. I think he's got a really good truck, and Mike Stefanik is driving where it's comfortable and trying to save some rubber. Roland said they're not playing the rain game here. He's saying save the truck. We think this thing will go green for a long time.
Well, we're about to go back to green flag racing. The pace truck has pulled into the pit lane area. It'll be the 43 of Jimmy Hensley. Three trucks are a lap down. Here we go. They're on the inside. Oh, and a slow start by the 27 of Robbie Thompson. Boy, he almost got rear-ended.
Sound like he missed a shift. Looked like he missed a shift on the start. Dennis Setzer going around this lap traffic. He tries to run down Mike Wallace.
That's the Mopar Dodge. Boy, what a great view out the front.
And just listen to the accelerator. They never go all the way down to the floor. Oh, we have got some traffic there. Ron Hornaday's trying to buffalo his way through. And also Stefanik trying to get on the inside of Stacy Compton.
On board with Andy Houston. He is running in 14th position. He's dropped a couple of spots. We had a spin. That's the smoke that you're seeing. That was David Starr. He got it going again before everybody came around on him. Rob Morgan, new sponsorship there in the 46 with Compact Computers, but he's going in the wrong direction. Battle continues. There's Marty Houston, the 75. Our pole sitter from last year, the 88 of Terry Cook. And Tony Roper in the 55 has taken over that ride for Ron Barfield and has been looking very good all day, BP.
Yes, he has. Another one of the fast trucks in the practice session this afternoon.
He's worked his way up to 17th. Right behind him is Randy Tolsma. That is four position right there. These three guys nose to tail. Napa Field summary, take a look. There would be a change in the points lead right now if the race ended. Jack Sprague would be back on top, but we've got a long way to go. We have only completed, well, we've got 198 laps to go. Let's make it real simple. Battle for 16th. Take a look at the speeds. Just under 97 miles per hour. Back to Setzer and Biffle. Those guys are still banging on each other. That is still a battle for 8th and 9th on the racetrack.
Right now, the leaders there, we see the leader, Jimmy Hensley in the Dodge truck, followed by Mike Bliss, the Exide battery truck.
Got a spinner down in turn one. Our race leader's heading that direction. There is the 7 of Tom Bambard. Jimmy Hensley gets around him okay. So far, the yellow has just come out.
Oh, man, I was hoping he was going to put it in reverse and we would not have the caution flag.
Bambard, his first race this year on the tour, has about 1,500 laps here at Louisville Motor Speedway. But obviously, the heavier truck got away from him as he spun it into turn number one. So our second caution here on lap number 32. He's having a little bit of trouble getting it out of the grass. Now he's underway.
I think he had trouble getting the vehicle started. He finally makes that happen. And
let's go back and take another look.
I'd almost say there's going to be some contact. Oh, yeah.
Got some help.
Someone gets in the back of Bambard, and looks like it was Stacy Compton in the RC Cola truck. And man, Stefanik right on the inside of the 60 as Bambard goes around and
green.
You heard the call from the spotter upstairs. We're back to green flag racing here on lap number 36. Jimmy Hensley gets a great jump over Mike Bliss.
Man, what a jump he got on that 99 truck of Bliss.
So Hensley, who is looking for a ride next year, takes an early lead here on the restart. There is Jack Sprague back in third. Joe Rutman right behind him. Jay Sauter has moved into fifth. Sauter qualified seventh. Rutman in the 18 truck also was strong. He qualified fifth. This guy's basically running in lockstep. You see the battle for third. Averages dropped down a little bit as we've gotten a little bit of tire wear. Also got to get the temperature back up after the restart.
And we see Sprague is dropping back from the front trim, so this GMAC truck is not exactly the way they want it. You wonder about some of these guys going for a long ways, might not be making a pit stop. I think that Sprague would want to make a pit stop and make some type of adjustment, because right now he's having trouble keeping up with the front two.
Well, he is now 1.3 seconds behind Bliss. Let's go on board with Mike Wallace, the team ASE Ultra Wheels Ford. That's a battle for sixth. You got Kevin Harvick right in front. Boy, Harvick's looking a little squirrely there.
Right now, Kevin Harvick started fourth, is back to sixth position. And once again, just listen to these engines. They never go all the way down to the floorboard. Just kind of play with the throttle and the steering wheel. And you hear there on the front straightaway, they're not using all the power that's available. Right here is the only place you're able to use any power at all.
Benny, the other thing you notice from the onboard especially, you're never really in the straightaway. You're always turning.
Always turning.
Kevin Harvick is a little bit tight right now. I just spoke with Rodney Haygood, his crew chief, and he said the truck is just a bit tight. They're going to ride it out for right now. But hey, Harvick is hot this week at Charlotte Motor Speedway. He finished second in an ARCA race, so don't feel like Kevin is not going to have a shot at things later tonight.
Yeah, and he had a ninth place finish on our last race at Las Vegas. There's the 75 of Marty Houston. He just brushed the front straightaway wall, kept it under control, though, and we'll have to wait to see what damage he's got. Looks like he's still under power, no flats.
He's kind of flattened the right side of that Spears manufacturing vehicle, though.
Let's go back and take another look.
As you can see, he comes off the corner. And I would guess there's a little bit of contact right there from Stefanik when he tries to get it sideways. When he turns back to the right, man, he's really sideways. When he turns back to the right to save it, the wall stops him.
So Marty Houston makes contact with the wall, but does not bring out the caution. In fact, he is still out on the racetrack. It did lose a few positions. He dropped back to 22nd now here as we've completed 46 laps.
That sixth vehicle is Ron Hornaday III.
That is Ron's son. This will be his last NASCAR Craftsman Truck race of 1999. They're trying to put together a full season package next year so Ronnie could go for Rookie of the Year honors. And you can see his best finish there, 16th, which was back at Nazareth.
And right behind this big group of trucks is the leader, Jimmy Hensley. Look what kind of mess he's going to be driving into in just a lap or two. Well, actually, he's already in it.
he is smack dab in the middle of it. And he's going to have to try and pick his way first around David Starr in the Vitamin Chevrolet. Look at the damage still there from the contact with the wall. So far, so good. That's Tony Roper in the Ice House beer wagon right in front of him. I think he's going to like that outside line right now, BB. I don't know if he wants to get down underneath all that traffic. Down in pit lane, Dave Burns and Amy East are patrolling the area. And the reason, we've had a couple of spins that put a couple guys out. First one is the number 7, and Tom Bambar, this is the second time he's been around.
We see the blue truck as it goes around, and I think this is what happened to Ron Hornaday. As we see Biffle go on the outside, there's Hornaday on the inside, the Napa truck, and I believe that his angle was so bad when he got down one, he just simply could not make the corner. Now then, here we see the 18 truck, the Dana Dodge of Joe Ruttman. A little tap from the 98 truck, and around, that's Kevin Harvick, the 98, around goes Ruttman. So we had three trucks spin on the last lap, on one lap.
And let's go on board with Mike Wallace, because he barely gets by here, BP.
We see Ruttman going around. Well, where do I go? Stay up there, Joe. There you go.
Tough break for Ruttman. He was running fourth, and we've got a pit stop for Hornaday. Dave?
Left side tires for Ron Hornaday. Track bar adjustment. Ron was complaining the truck was very tight. Steve Beal makes the call. The guys get the work done. Amy East.
Involved in that crash was also Joe Ruttman. He came in for right side tires. They're now getting those off. The fresh ones are being bolted on. They topped it off with fuel. Just a matter of time here. I'm on the opposite side, but it looks a little lengthy, so he's out. Little bit longer stop than I think they were anticipating.
We'll have to see exactly how it's going to affect him. BP, we probably should explain how pit road is set up here.
We saw them pitting on the figure eight racetrack or the quarter mile racetrack, and now in the exit, they can't go back on the racetrack. They got to go back on the access road on the inside of turns 1 and 2, and as they go by the entrance to pit road, now they fall in at the back of the field.
So Jimmy Hensley is still your race leader.
Right,
we're
going
to go back to green flag racing.
Get ready. Green, green, green.
And we're back to green flag with Jimmy Hensley again getting a great restart over Mike Bliss. Whoa, it's getting greasy down in one.
And the 17 of David Starr and the 90 of Lance Norrick all of a sudden were side by side, and the 24 almost got up in the wall. And the 90 car of Lance Norrick gets black flag. One of the 90 or 17.
Yeah, it's either Norrick or the 17 of David Starr's gotten a black flag. We'll sort it out for you here real quickly. There is Sprague. He's trying to get around Starr. Sauter right behind him. That is a battle for third. It's Hensley, Bliss, Sprague, Sauter, and Harvick. That's your top five.
And the three truck of Sauter's on the inside of Jack Sprague. And if he gets position, here come will come the 98 as well of Kevin Harvick.
So Sauter takes over the position. Here comes Harvick underneath. And you're right, Benny. Sprague's got a problem. That truck is just not handling as well as it did during practice and qualifying.
And whoa, just a little bit of contact with Mike Wallace. And the Sprague gets down to the inside for some contact. And around goes Sprague.
He keeps it off the wall. Spinner. And boy, Sprague, what a great recovery. The fans are on their feet.
And no caution flag, because he spun around and kept the vehicle going. There is no caution. And the 17 of Starr continues to get the black flag.
Well, they'll stop scoring him after a while if he doesn't answer it. Meanwhile, look at the lead that Hensley has built up, about 7/10 of a second over Mike Bliss. What a recovery. That may be the highlight if Jack Sprague comes back to win this championship. Because if he puts it in the wall there, he's done with two races to go. What a great save. Sprague does fall back to sixth after the spin. So it's now Hensley, Bliss, Sauter, Harvick, Mike Wallace, and Jack Sprague. That's your top six. He's never done better than eighth here. This has not been one of his favorite tracks, but as he said right before we went on the broadcast on RPM tonight, they went testing for 3 days because that's how important this racetrack was to them.
They went to a racetrack similar to this, New Asheville Speedway up in Asheville, North Carolina, almost as round as this racetrack, where you're never able to use. Oh, we once again got some spinners.
Got three trucks involved.
Right here we see the replay. The 24 truck gets some contact from Mike Bliss. And watch this, folks. This is a terrific job. Nails the gas, keeps it going around in 360, and continues on. Didn't even bring up the caution flag. But meanwhile, the smoke behind the trucks. Andy Houston goes down pit road, almost spins out as he tries to exit the racetrack.
And this is what happened while we were looking at the replay. Ronnie Hornaday got into an accident with Tony Roper. The two of them have damage. The worst of it goes to the number six, the Lucas Oil Chevy of Ronnie Hornaday.
And I think Kevin Zawinski, the auto design truck, was involved as well because some, let's see, there we see trucks going by. Right there we see the six of Ronnie Hornaday spin as he comes off the corner. No contact. And there, the 31 vehicle of Kozwinski is also involved. And I tell you what, Roper must have some pretty serious damage to the right side of that vehicle, because look at the damage on the nose of Ronnie Hornaday's car.
Yeah.
Truck.
There is Sawinski. He is an innocent victim getting swept up in this one. We'll sort it out for you when we come back. Jimmy Hensley's up front. We're under our fourth caution of the evening here at Louisville Motor Speedway, round 23 of 25 of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series. And it has been a thriller so far involving all the key players. Let's sort this out for you, because if you were with us the last segment, you know the great save that Jack Sprague made. He's holding on to sixth position. There's Jimmy Hensley at the front of this pack. But let's also bring you up to date. Biffle is in 11th place, and so our points championship is still being contested hot and heavy. Want to welcome everybody from ESPN after Atlanta's 5-3 victory over Houston in the playoffs. Atlanta now has a 2-1 edge over the Astros, and we're here at Louisville Motor Speedway. Marty Reed along with Benny Parsons, Dave Burns, and Amy East. Let's take a look at what happened to Jack Sprague. Second in the points by 10. BP.
Right there, he gets some contact, but Mike Wallace doesn't do anything. But once again here, some contact. Around goes Jack Sprague, nails the gas, does a 360, continues on, only lost a couple of positions.
He is running in sixth position. Amy?
Well, what happened down here in the 24 pit? They said originally Jack's truck was very tight, and that's what pushed him to that outside groove. That was the trouble that really had him being passed by a lot of trucks. But now they're wondering, why isn't the black flag coming out for Mike Wallace? They said, remember Nazareth when we bumped him? Well, now he's bumped us twice, and we're in it for the championship. Jack's fired up. His lap times were faster after that spin than before. So look for Jack to be strong. Dave Burns.
Amy, Ron Hornaday came in. We thought he might be coming in for right side tires to match the lefts he put on. He did not. They changed a left front tire, and he put a half rubber in the left front to loosen the truck up. Now, Andy Houston, who had that off-road experience, as we go green now, Rick Wren says he radioed in. He said the truck is fine, and Andy's staying out.
Joe Ruttman trying to get his lap back after running fourth and getting tangled up in a spin with an assist from Kevin Harvick. He's trying to get ahead of our race leader, Jimmy Hensley, and he's done it. So he's at the tail end of the lead lap. Can he hold on, BP?
Well, Jimmy Hensley comes back. We see the vehicles go there. We see the trucks side by side. Jimmy Hensley's Dodge truck is terrific tonight.
Mike Bliss is watching all this, and he's saying, okay, guys, you want to take each other? I'll just wait for you. Boy, old Ruttman got a little loose there through one. Hensley now opens up a sizable margin again. He has been excellent on these restarts, Benny. We've had four cautions, and he's had the best jump every single time of anybody on the racetrack. Mike Bliss in the X-Side Ford is in second place. Then it is 2.4 seconds back to Jay Sauter in third. Kevin Harvick is fourth. Mike Wallace is fifth. Dave, you got more on Jimmy?
You know, guys, every time Jimmy Hensley has led a race in 1999, he's finished in the top 10. Most recently, when he led two laps at Las Vegas, he finished seventh. And the win at Martinsville early this year, he led 37, including the most important lap, the last one.
You know what's amazing? He's completed every lap that he's run here in 96, 97, and 98. Oh, big crash on the front straightaway involving several trucks. The caution flag is out. Did Biffle get through?
Biffle, the points, the guy that came in with a 10-point lead, might have been able to drive through that. He was right in the middle of it, and we'll have to look at his truck when he comes by and go back to the replay and see if there's any contact. There was some contact to the left front and to the left rear. It doesn't look like it's going to really be a major thing, but he might have to make a pit stop to get the metal off the tire.
This is Biffle's road course truck. This is the backup. They backed the primary into the wall late in the practice session. Literally with no practice laps, he came out in this truck and put it ninth on the grid, and now your points leader by 10 is in some damage control situation as he is in our fifth caution, lap number 81. He is shown right now in 11th position. Let's go back and take another look.
There we see the 88 truck, Terry Cook, Big Daddy's barbecue sauce, Lance Norrick, Tim Steele in 21. And we see the 80, the 46 truck had spun, was sitting in the middle of the racetrack. Wow.
Stefanik is involved, Andy Houston, Kevin Sawinski again, Randy Tolsma in the 25. This has taken out a lot of trucks for some damage repair. Take another look.
Never see Rob Morgan, the 46 truck. I don't think there was contact. I think he was trying to get under a truck when he spun coming off the corner.
Terry Cook had nowhere to go in the 88.
No.
There goes Biffle sneaking through with minor damage compared to everybody else. Look at Bambard. That's his third crash and spin.
Andy Houston, the Cat Runnel, Chevrolet, we ride along with him.
Look out.
Oh, some contact with Stefanik.
Any truck that goes home with a clean quarter panel, it's a major victory at this track. It is a very physical place. There is the damage to Rob Morgan's Axiom Compact Ford. His best run this season was a fifth. Back at Topeka on the road course, that's his specialty. Biffle has gone into the pit area. They're putting oil dry down, and there is the Granger Ford into the pits. So, Dave, you're there?
Points leader Greg Biffle by the slimmest of margins. They're going to snip away the sheet metal on the left front or tape it back. It looks like it's going to be a tape job. It's still there. They changed left side tires. Greg did not report in that he had significant damage, nor that the truck was a handful. So they think it's okay for the moment.
I couldn't hit 406 if you gave me a lifetime to work at it.
Me either. All right, the cleanup is just about complete, but now they have to once again run through the oil dry that's been put down.
Let's bring you up to speed on what has happened if you're just joining us here on ESPN. Round 23 of 25. This was Carl Long. He blew a line, got into his own fluid, and spun it around. Then contact. Mike Wallace gets into Jack Sprague. He makes a miraculous spin save. Does not make contact with the wall. Drop back to sixth position. Then Andy Houston on board. Take a look at all the banging going on in front of him. That's Stefanik, about six trucks involved. And that's just part of what's going on. Back Terry Cook, you can see the radiator. He's in the pit lane, and he was involved in that last one. He was a sandwich. I mean, he had nowhere to go. And he was our pole sitter here last year. How quickly the tide can turn for you. There you can see the crew still working feverishly. Terry, last time out at Las Vegas, had a great run, finished in the 10th position. On board with Dennis Setzer in the Mopar Dodge, and the need to lead in the short tracks. Do you know Dennis Setzer has the best average finishing position? But this is his first time here at Louisville Motor Speedway. Had never seen it before today. Take a look at the guy at the bottom. He's led 394 laps, but the average finish for Hornaday, 12.2. And BP, it's been 19 races since the guy in that Napa Chevrolet right in front of us there has been to victory lane.
And right now, Ron Hornaday is in 17th position, one lap down, after he spun down in turn one earlier on and was put a lap down.
He's got 15 short track wins in his career. That's more than Super Speedway and road courses combined. So don't count him out of this one. 15 trucks are on the lead lap. He's going to have to get a lap back if Hornaday's going to get back into this one. But we've seen that happen here many times at Louisville Motor Speedway. This just under a half mile bull ring. Lights are still on the pace truck. Let's reset the top five for you as it is. Jimmy Hensley, Mike Bliss, Jay Sauter, Kevin Harvick, and Mike Wallace. That's your top five. Then it's Jack Sprague in sixth, Dennis Setzer in seventh, Rick Crawford in eighth, Stacy Compton in ninth, and Greg Biffle in tenth. So all four of our key players in the championship chase are in the top ten. And well, look at the damage on that Royal Crown Cola Dodge. It is. Your truck just doesn't survive this track. I mean, there's no way. It's just so close. So much beating and banging going on. Dave, you got more on Stacy?
Well, Stacy leads the trucks that came in for pits that time, Marty. And when he came in, they put on right side tires and pulled the fender out on the 86 truck. It was still just a little bit tight, according to crew chief Kevin Cram. Now, as for the leader, Jimmy Hensley, at the beginning of the race, I talked to Fred Wanky, and he said, of course, they wanted to go out and lead this thing. But they also said, Fred said to me, under no circumstances do we want to pit. We want to go all the way. We want to just stay out there the whole time. We don't want to come in. And, Benny, I think we've already decided if this thing does go the entire distance, they're going to have to come in for fuel at some point.
You would think so, because they've got to run about 90 miles, although after you and I talked, Dave, I talked to some of those guys, and they said you really never use the entire carburetor, so it's possible they get 90 miles to a tank of fuel.
Jay Sauter has not done well here in the past. His finishes have been like 20th and 31st, but he's got big news. He's going to be running the 43 Busch car next year. Just been announced today.
Bragajanian and Kerb, Gene Need, the crew chief. We're excited about
ready,
that.
Ready.
We're getting ready to go back to green flag racing. And Hornaday tries to get the start. Oh, he's sideways. He sort of carons off Hensley. Here comes the X-side Ford. Bliss takes advantage and takes over the lead. Can he hold on to it? Boy, Hornaday wanted his lap back desperately. Mike Wallace gets hung out on the high side. Hornaday is on the tail end of the lead lap, and we've had our first lead change. Mike Bliss is now your race leader. Look at all the oil dry. These guys, we're dirt tracking.
It looks like they're dirt tracking down that corner. You're exactly right.
Bliss's best short track finish this year, fifth back at Indianapolis Raceway Park. Take a look at the restart again. Watch the 16.
Hornaday lays back and gasses it, gets a great start, and just goes up and leans on that 43 truck, and then get down in the oil dry and start dirt tracking.
I think that's called a carom shot. And boy, look at this. Hansen almost spun it around. That oil drive, very slick. Right now, it is the X-side Ford, the second truck in line there of Mike Bliss. He's got the race lead. Jimmy Hensley is in second. Sauter is in third.
Hensley wanted to go up and try the outside line, and you saw, folks, as well as Jimmy Hensley, that did not work too well.
They are still sliding through that turn 1-2 complex.
And Dennis Setzer appears to be off the pace. Well, no, I guess he's back on. Maybe there was some contact between him and Compton, but he's now seems to be okay.
He's going to drop back a few positions, though. He was running in seventh. He's dropped back 2 to 9th. Listen in, maybe see what's going on. Let's take another look at it. Setzer in the number one Mopar Dodge.
Oh, I see he gets a bump on the 14 of Rick Crawford and almost gets it sideways. About right here is when I looked up and saw him slow.
Meanwhile,
man, oh man, look at this battle going on.
Freight train. Now, the 16 of Ron Hornaday is at the tail end of the lead lap. It is Mike Bliss in the 99, your race leader, but here comes Hensley on the outside. He's going to try it again.
On the outside, if he makes this work, he will be All-American Superman.
Doesn't get it done just yet. Boy, he's in a very vulnerable position. All it takes is one little tap, but he's got it.
Put the S on his chest. He is Superman. Wow, what a pass.
Don't tug on my cape, buddy. And now he's going after Hornaday. And you know what? He's got to be thinking about, hey, you used me for a little carom shot, buddy. See ya.
You see Hornaday said, okay, Jimmy, go ahead. You got it.
Definitely the best truck on the racetrack right now is our Napa Field summary in the upper left-hand portion of your screen. Jimmy Hensley, oh, we got another spinner in turn number 2. Look out. That's Robbie Thompson.
Beat him back the line. Don't let him back.
They're telling him, don't let him around.
Run him, Jimmy, run him.
Oh, Hornaday's going to get that lap back.
So Hornaday, you heard the crew telling him, don't let him get the lap back, but he did. We'll have to wait and see, but I think NASCAR will let him get the lap back because he was in contact with the race leader. So back to green flag racing here at Louisville Motor Speedway at 105. 113 is the midway point, and there is rain off into the distance, so it is important. Jimmy Hensley is your race leader. The 75 of Marty Houston had gotten by him momentarily, BP, but boy, Hensley's just too strong.
He is too strong.
Houston was trying to get his lap back. He is shown right now in 15th position. First truck, one lap down. There is Greg Biffle, our current points leader by 10 coming in. He is 14th position, Dave.
Marty, he came in and he gave up 11th position to take on right side tires. But the hero of that pit stop was Jay Hsu, the catch can man. When the guys went around to change right side tires in the rear, the hose got caught in the left rear fender. And because of the bending that's happened back there, the hose got really, really caught. Jay reached back in there. He tugged once, twice, three times, and then gave it a huge yank and got it out of there before Greg left pit road. By the way, Greg is also the cook and the hauler driver. I'm sorry, Jay is also the cook and the hauler driver, a hero here tonight at Louisville.
Yeah, I didn't think it was Biffle that did the hauling and cooking also. Take a look at the points, upper left-hand part of your screen. If the race ended right now, Sprague would be your leader by 19. Setzer would be 43 back. Compton's still in it, but he'd be 93 back.
Randy Tolsman doing a good job. He started in 14th position on this restart, and right now is trying to work his way up to the 11th, has worked his way up to the 11th position.
Trying to get under David Starr. Starr is several laps down. He's had several incidents into spins and contact. Whoa, all of a sudden, here comes Hornaday on the outside of the 25. That is a battle for 11th on the racetrack between those two.
Right now, the 25 vehicle is smoking, so I think that he's lost a cylinder. The engine is not running up to par anyway as both Hornaday and Biffle go by.
And here comes Stefanik. So all of this for position. So Randy Tolsma, one moment looking extremely good, and all of a sudden there's that puff of smoke you mentioned, BP. And you can see the fire just intermittent out of the left bank, and it looks like he's in some trouble. He's losing ground to Biffle and Hornaday. And Hornaday shown right now 11th, Biffle 12th, Tolsma's in 13th.
And the smoke is getting a little bit worse on Tolsma. Here's back to the second position. Mike Bliss, the X-Side Ford, and Jay Sauter, the GM Goodrich Chevy. And right now, Sauter is all over the back of that number 99. But the battle is going on about 2.5 seconds behind the leader, Jimmy Hensley.
Yeah, Hensley has taken 2.6 seconds that last time by, and we have passed the halfway mark, so Jimmy gets the Gatorade bonus money, and this race is now official. So if it does happen to rain, it will be an official event. So stay with us. We got to take a commercial break. There is your race leader, Jimmy Hensley, here at the Kroger 225. Drop back to 9th and 10th, respectively, as you're on board with Mike Wallace. And again, if you're not familiar with the rules, under caution in the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series, you can only take two tires, and it makes this strategy very interesting, BP.
Very, very interesting. And Rick Crawford, I guess, did, in fact, lose a lap on that spin that he had over in the corner. See,
back to green flag racing at the end of our seventh caution period at lap number 130. 225 is the race distance. Joe Ruttman trying to get his lap back. He is one lap down. This is the second time he's tried it. Hensley didn't let him do it the first time. He may not let him do it again.
Look at Jimmy Hensley just turn that truck left and turn under Joe Ruttman, get alongside. What a terrific job that Jimmy Hensley, Fred Wanky, that entire crew have done tonight, getting this Mopar Dodge set up.
Dave, you got more on Jimmy Hensley's situation? He hasn't pitted yet.
Yeah, and it helps, Benny, it adds to what you just said. And Jimmy radioed into Fred Wanky, and he said, well, how are those guys time-wise that put on tires? And Fred radioed back and said, Jimmy, they don't have anything for us. As for Jay Sauter, I talked with Todd Barrier and said, Todd, when do you guys need to come in? And he shook his head no and gave me like a safe signal in baseball. They don't want to come in either.
Wow.
So this is going to be interesting between those two. As we take a look at our Dodge race recap, our leader is Jimmy Hensley. He has led 124 of 132 laps. We've got seven cautions for 35 laps. Our average speed is down to 59 miles an hour. And the only other guy to lead besides Jimmy Hensley has been Mike Bliss, and that was all of eight laps. Off the track right now, Rob Morgan, Terry Cook, Kevin Sawinski. Those guys can't buy a break tonight. Out of the race, Randy Tolsman has just dropped out. Tim Steele, Tom Bambard, Ron Hornaday III, and Jeff Spraker. And Jimmy Hensley has got that thing on rails. Look at 98. There was Kevin Harvick going through in third. Then here is fourth place. That is Jack Sprague. And right behind him, fifth of Stacy Compton. So a lot of our championship contenders as we go on board with Andy Houston in sixth place, the Cat Rental Chevy.
I'm just amazed how little they're able to use the accelerator on this Louisville Motor Speedway.
Well, that goes back to what we were talking about a little bit earlier as far as the fuel economy with all these yellow laps. It's going to be interesting to see if Hensley and Sauter can make this strategy work for them. They're saving the tires as best they can. So far, they are running well out of fresher tires.
Oh, some contact between Bliss and his teammate Greg Biffle. Meanwhile, Andy Houston tries to close up on the back of the 86 truck, and we see once Stacy Compton's right front still smoking with that contact that he had with the other vehicle of Rick Crawford.
There's Dennis Setzer. We go on board the Mopar Dodge. Right in front of him is the XI Ford. That is Mike Bliss in eighth. Biffle is in front of him in seventh. So the Killer Bees running seventh and eighth. And oh, look out. He takes the position away from his teammate. That's hurting the points championship chase. And boy, Biffle's in trouble. He goes around.
He goes around. He nails it and hits the wall hard.
The front section of the Granger Ford has got some serious front end damage and a lot of smoke.
And the caution flag is out.
And Biffle's having a hard time making his way towards pit lane. Finally gets it turned in. The whole complexion of the championship, look at the left rear, has changed dramatically.
There was contact between he and Dennis Setzer as he tried to get back in the hole that Mike Bliss had opened. He tried to get back in the hole, and there was contact, and that's what caused the left rear tire to go flat.
The dream season at Las Vegas, this team had won its ninth race, claimed the manufacturer's championship for Ford, had a 130-point lead. Then came the penalty for the unapproved part. All of a sudden, it was a 10-point lead. And now, look at the Granger Ford, and he's going to have to wait. And Greg Biffle is going to be at least one lap down, BP.
I think it's going to be two laps down.
Let's go back, take another look.
All right, here we come down the front straightaway. Right here, Bliss gets in the corner. They make contact. Now, Dennis set to the one truck. He's going to try to get in there as well. So right there is where they make contact, and right there is where the left rear tire goes flat.
And once that tire went flat, Biffle was a passenger. Take a look one more. Take a look at that. Left rear is down.
It's already, it just, once again, we see a piece of debris flying off. Just slight contact, but just enough to cut that left rear tire down.
In 2 weeks, the dream has turned into a potential nightmare for the Granger Ford team and Greg Biffle. We talked about this on the open. This track, if you survive this racetrack, and with any kind of position, it's a major victory. And right now, you can see the results of it vividly on the Granger Ford. Biffle is shown in 16th position, two laps down. The last time Greg did not complete every lap of a race, that was back at Nashville, BP.
It's been a tough day. Meanwhile, the trucks seem to be getting lined up for a restart once again. We have not been given the signal one to go.
Coming out of the pit lane area right now, Kevin Harvick has made a stop. Ron Hornaday made another stop. Biffle came back in as well. There is Jimmy Hensley and Jay Sauter. Those two guys refused to stop.
They just refused to stop. And also, Jack Sprague has not stopped either.
Sprague got a pretty good-looking truck there, the 24. Not too much damage, at least on the right side. The rear, he's got a little bit of rub on the left. The big tire donut on the 2. Take a look at the full grandstands of Louisville Motor Speedway. Not very few. There's just a few seats, and they're the ones down low by the racetrack that are vacant. Everything else is jam-packed all the way around this facility. There's Kevin Harvick. This may get the best-appearing truck of the night so far, not a scratch. Dave, can you explain how he's kept this thing in one piece?
Excellent driving, Marty. Actually, Kevin said to Rodney Haygood, don't change a thing on the truck, just give me right side tires. And I asked Rodney about that and the fuel strategy. I said, do you think the leaders have to pit? And he said, we did. So Rodney knew that they could not play the rain game. They don't even have anybody watching the radar. They knew they had to come in for at least one pit stop. Now, I just talked with Fred Wanky, crew chief on the 43 of Jimmy Hensley. I said, Fred, can you guys go the entire distance? Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
This is going to be great.
Oh, yeah.
Let's take a look at our Napa full field summary. You can see exactly where they started, the parentheses on the right-hand side. Sauter, you know, Hensley and Sauter, they've won the last two Martinsville races, so another short track battle shaping up here. Sprague would be your points leader as of right now. Compton, Andy Houston, Mike Bliss, Setzer, Wallace, Harvick, Hornaday, Stefanik, the last truck on the lead lap. Then it's Ruttman a lap down with Crawford, Marty Houston, and Ron Barfield two laps down.
Greg Biffle, who came in with the points lead, is now in 16th spot. As we're looking at Randy Goss, the crew chief on Biffle's truck, and never see the Granger truck beat up right and left and front.
If this was the Friday night fights, he has taken a pounding.
He would have lost.
We're getting ready to go back to green flag racing here. This is the end of our eighth caution of the evening. The record is 13 back in 1997. We don't want to set it, believe me.
Green, green, green.
You got the word. We're restarting on lap 151 of 225. And again, Rutman's going to try and get his lap back.
And also Rick Crawford makes it three wide going down the backstretch.
Crawford gets both of them. Crawford, who got spun around, comes back to get back onto the lead lap. In fact, he's now shown in 12th position. 13th is the 18 of Joe Ruttman. And then there's your two race leaders, first and second place, the 43 Dodge of Jimmy Hensley and the Goodrich Chevrolet of Jay Sauter. 73 laps remaining here at this just under a half mile bullring at Louisville Motor Speedway. This actually back further in the pack. There is, did Bliss get around Compton?
Yes, he did. Yes, Mike, sir. Bliss, the X-Side truck, may have one of the better trucks here tonight as he tries to get under the 40 trucks. Some contact between them. The 40 goes around in front of the field.
Barfield, can he keep from getting into anybody? Yes. Will the caution come out? They're waiting to see if he can get it refired. So far, no yellow. We're still green. A lot of smoke from Andy Houston's truck. Meanwhile, the yellow does come out because Joe Ruttman has slid up into the wall.
And Rick Crawford will get a lap down. Look at the smoke out of the back of Andy Houston's truck.
Change that right rear, pull a fender away from it.
Yeah, they're talking about fender rub. Yeah, there it is on the Cat Rental Chevrolet. And there is the damage to Ron Barfield. That is a Rick McCray-owned machine, and he is teamed up for the rest of the season after leaving the Ice House number 55 ride. And boy, look at the flat left front.
Yeah, that's exactly what's wrong.
And right now, he's giving us a great fireworks display here.
He just goes down through the grass. I don't know where he's going, but he's going in the grass to get there. I guess he wants to get to the pits and change that tire. He did not want to lose another lap.
He has hustled his way around and makes his way into the pit lane. Jack Sprague is under attack from Mike Bliss, and Bliss is going to take second spot.
With ease. Right now, Mike Bliss might be a match for Jimmy Hendrix because, remember, Bliss has stopped. He has changed, I think, right side tires. That could be very important.
So you're looking at Bliss in second, then Sprague in third. Now the 50 truck of... the Granger Ford of Greg Biffle, he is two laps down in 15th position. Stacy Compton is actually in fourth position right behind him.
And you can look at the Granger Ford and kind of figure why he's two laps down.
There is Compton, 2.1 seconds behind the race leader. Fifth place is the number two of Mike Wallace. And Wallace is right behind these two. In fact, there he goes through the screen. Then Dennis Setzer is sixth. Ron Hornaday is seventh. Kevin Harvick is eighth. Those guys are in a bit of a log jam back there. Compton has his hands full. There is Wallace. Compton's trying to get around Biffle, but cannot get the job done.
And right now, Greg's a couple laps down, so...
BP. NAPA field summary in the upper left-hand portion of your screen. On board with Mike Wallace. Uh-oh, some smoke from Biffle. He's got a tire rub. Hear the throttle response. Battle for seven.
Got one truck on it, too. Got one of them.
That is Kevin Harvick getting around Ron Hornaday. And there is Andy Houston just getting off the racetrack in time after spinning down in turn one, BP.
And the caution flag comes out, and he will, looks like, lose a lap if he doesn't beat Jimmy Hensley back to the line. But Joe Rutten is going to get a lap back.
So we gain one back onto the lead lap and lose one. So we still have 12 trucks. Let's get an update on Andy Houston. Amy?
Well, with all the frequent stops here on pit lane, when Rick Wren went to that right rear, he found that something was leaking from the back of the 60 truck. It turns out it was gear oil. They did what they could with tie straps, rad light, but obviously that wasn't enough. They're speculating he got in his own oil, but that's really tough here at Louisville. It could have just been a tap from another truck. Regardless, they'll probably bring him back in here shortly.
Well, it looks like he's been doing some off-road racing with all the dust that's built up on the truck. Let's go back, take another look.
Three abreast is a good start to why we're going to have a spin here. And there we see the contact between he and the white truck on the outside and Terry Cook. And that was a 27 truck of Robbie Thompson involved as well. And this was right in front of leaders. And he's sitting there in all that smoke and a little concerned there for a little bit.
Take another look at it there. You're right, BP. He gets back out onto the racetrack and did an excellent job of clearing the area just before the leaders came through.
You saw the leaders just starting down the front stretch off turn four.
Let's go on board one more time with Andy.
That's the most accelerator he used all night, trying to get the truck spun around.
He quickly got it off the racetrack. There is Jimmy Hensley, has yet to make a pit stop. We have completed 174 laps of 225. The big question in everyone's mind is, can he make it all the way without stopping? Dave?
Well, they are talking about it down here, Marty. Before this caution flag, according to their count, they had run 64 caution laps. Now, as y'all know, you get about twice as much fuel mileage on a caution lap as you do on a green flag lap. Now, I don't have that all figured out, but they're down here talking about it. They thought they might come in. So far, Jimmy Hensley has not brought the Dodge by Petty Ram onto pit lane.
Interesting point. No one has ever won from the pole, so Hensley could make some history tonight.
But, Marty, if they don't pit pretty soon, they might as well not pit, because right now he'd only have about 50 laps to try to work his way back to the front. And the closer we get to the end gives him less time to try to work his way back to the front. So they either pit now or just bite the bullet and say, okay, we're going all the way.
Well, a perfect example is the guy sitting right behind him in second place. Remember, Mike Bliss about 40 laps ago was running about seventh. And now he finds himself fighting his way into second. So we'll find out how the strategy unfolds when we return to Louisville.
Don't go away.
See Compton, fourth in the points, has spun her around a flat left front.
Has a flat left front tire. He spun and the caution flag comes out. And now Biffle is going to get one of his laps back. And Marty Houston is going to get a lap back as well. The 86 truck will go a lap down. He spun on the front straightaway with contact with another vehicle. I'm not sure exactly which may cause the left front tire to go flat. He tried to go around one more time and could not make it.
So Stacy Compton, who came into this race fourth in the points, we are at our 11th caution here on lap number 81. Stacy was 54 points out of third and 95 out of first. Take a look.
You see Mike Wallace on the inside, the two truck, and there's a contact, which caused Stacy Compton, the RC Cola Dodge, to spin. Around he goes. Now, I'm not sure where this flat left front tire comes into play, unless he ran over a piece of debris as he tried to leave, because it was the left rear that Mike Wallace made the contact with.
Get another view from a different angle.
See, there you go. He never got to the left front. I don't know, unless the flat spots or sliding the left front across the racetrack caused it. Or, once again, a piece of debris, because with all this damage, right along with Mike Wallace, Team ASE, Ford onboard camera.
Well, that's Mike's second contact tonight. He got in with Sprague. Might not be real popular with a couple of the guys by the end of this evening. Compton has gotten the tire repaired and has pulled back out onto the racetrack. He is one lap down. Let's get an update, Amy.
Well, it was a left front tire, and I wish I could tell you how that happened, because, again, that's not where the initial contact was. Down here in the 86, they were not expecting that. Their biggest dilemma up to this point was fuel, because on the one stop they had made, there was so much sheet metal damage on the left rear that they could not get any fuel in. Dave Burns.
Amy, Jimmy Hensley came in last time while we were away at commercial and put on right side tires and took on fuel. Fred Wanky says that's because we couldn't beat the 99. So, with that being at the back of the pack and nothing to lose, they put on left side tires. And so now, the 43 believes they're going to have a truck that can go through this pack and have something for Mike Bliss in the X-Side Ford.
Well, we've got 12 trucks on the lead lap, so this may turn out to be a great strategic move, because Hensley did blink right as we went to commercial break, and then as soon as we came back, we had the spin. We never got a chance to really update his situation. So he has got four fresh tires in 12th place on board with Mike Wallace. It's Ron Barfield, who is several laps down.
Mike Wallace trying to get on the inside of Barfield, take the spot away. He does.
Barfield is 19th position, four laps down to be exact. And now here comes Dennis Setzer trying to get around the number 40. If you're tuning in saying, wait a minute, I thought Barfield drove the 55. That was until this race. He has now moved over with Rick McRae. Tony Roper has taken his spot. Setzer gets by him. Here comes Kevin Harvick in fifth. Look at the log jam. There is Jimmy Hensley getting underneath both the 60 of Andy Houston and Greg Biffle. Remember, he's got four fresh tires. He's moved up to eighth position already, BP. Started at 12th on this restart. On board with Houston, that's Hensley right in front of him. This is what Hensley's got to be careful of. Whoa! Hensley goes high. He's going to drop a couple of positions, at least to lap vehicles. all of a sudden, the Dodge is an ill-handling truck. What happened, BP?
I don't know. It looks like he's gotten up in the loose stuff, the debris, and got it on his tires, and it's going to take him a lap or two to get those tires cleaned back off.
Now he's trying to get down to the low side, get under Dave Starr. Back to the battle for the race lead with 32 laps to go. Mike Bliss has got mirrors full of Jack Sprague. Dave, you got more on Sprague's strategy?
Marty, the report from the Sprague pit all night long has been stay out, stay out. During that last caution, Rick Hendrick, truck owner, came through on a cell phone, talked to the crew, talked to the driver, told Jack, be smooth, and said to Dennis Conner about the strategy to stay out. He suggested that might be a good idea.
Well, Sprague, the last time he won on a short track was Bristol, 14 races ago. Mike Bliss in four tries here. His best finish ever here in Louisville has been second place. These guys are duking it out with 29 laps to go. We'll tell you that Hensley is back in eighth position still. Take a look at the Napa Field summary. You can see that Jack Sprague would be your new points leader if the race ended right now.
And right now, Sprague in that GMAC truck is a little bit faster than last time. They're almost exactly the same speed. Why? Because they're bumper to bumper. They're only going to go as fast as the 99 truck goes.
These two complete lap number 198. We've got 27 laps to go. And Hensley is about almost a half a lap behind. Looking at my stopwatch, he is 5.9 seconds behind, Benny. They may have waited too long to stop.
Just might have.
Hensley had the dominant truck all race long. Bliss was right there with him, but could not. He led about eight laps, actually, until Hensley finally gave it up. Third is Jay Sauter, but back in seventh, look at Jimmy Hensley. He is cutting away into this group, trying to work his way back into position to get into this between now and the finish of this race. We've got a spin on the front straightaway. Two trucks now sliding into turn number one. Here they are, the 17 of David Starr and the 75 of Marty Houston. And that is going to bring out our 12th caution of the night.
See a little fire under this 17 truck. I don't, David Starr.
Vitamix Chevrolet, David, I don't think he realizes that he's got that fire underneath there. The fire crews are waiting to get across the track right now. They've got fire bottles in hand. Let's go back and take another look, BP.
There we see the 17 car go down, and he gets loose as he comes off the corner. He goes up, makes contact, just drives in and comes back and collects the 75, which spins him around. And the 75 of Marty Houston is going to spin. There we see the contact. Ooh, the rear tires come off the ground, and he'll come around and smack this wall hard with the left side.
So the Spear Chevrolet, an innocent victim in this one, but boy, the damage is severe. And Marty was on the lead lap, so that is a very tough break for him. There's David Starr. It's just not been one of his better nights.
And another driver that hurts his chances of winning the race tonight is Jimmy Hensley, because Hensley's now has worked his way back up to seventh position. It's just no way that he's going to get by the six trucks in front of him. Right now, we only have 13 laps to go, and it's going to take a while to clean this mess up. So basically, all he's going to have is five or six green flag laps to try to catch these other trucks.
But remember, the 10-lap rule will come into effect, and there's Marty Houston. And he's obviously disappointed because he had a good run going in the Spear Chevrolet. Was into the lead lap, getting consolation from team members. They knew they had that truck dialed in pretty good for a change. And, you know, that team's been slowly but surely coming together. They're going to be back on tour next year. There is Jimmy Hensley. Dave, you've got his crew chief, Fred Wanky.
I do, Marty, and a while ago, Fred asked me if I wanted to take his job and he could switch with me, and no way. You've had to make some tough calls tonight. Where are you right now? Does Jimmy have enough time to get this done?
Well, it just all depends on how soon they get the track cleaned up. Jimmy is just doing an awesome job tonight. The Dodge Papetti is running really good. You know, we just keep hearing that the rain's 10 miles away and it's 10 minutes away, and I, you know, we were really good, and then it started getting tight. and we had to come in. You know, I had not planned on coming in. We was going to stay out and run the whole race. But it got tight right there at the end, and Bliss was coming, and we wasn't going to be able to hold him off. And now, it just seems here lately we can't get a caution at the right time. Now, it looks like there's only going to be 4 or 5 laps, but I'm sure we can get some of them. Everybody's working hard, and Jimmy's doing a good job. The motor room, the guys in the shop, I mean, we haven't give up.
All right, they're hanging in there. Amy East, what's going on your end?
Well, I'm with Matt Chambers. He's the crew chief for Mike Bliss. You're out front. This is crunch time. What do you guys have? Can Mike stay out front for the rest of this race?
Yeah, next side four is doing real good. We came in and put left side tires on. Sprague hasn't stopped at all yet, so we're better than he is, but we didn't get any fuel in it on our pit stop because the dry brakes all smashed in. So we're crossing our fingers, hoping we got enough fuel to make it to the end. But Mike Bliss is doing a great job for us, and we're real excited about it, coming out with a good finish. We're taking a gamble, but we're looking forward to it.
Okay, well, he's taking a gamble, and he was also crunching numbers on the calculator when I came up here. So let's watch that 99 and see if he can hold on and win this thing.
Well, Bliss won back at Topeka. But 30th at Las Vegas, our last time out. Talk about night racing. Well, when the lights come on, we've seen that the action gets hot, heavy, and sometimes it's take no prisoners. Up to fifth is Jimmy Hensley. There he is, right behind the number two of Mike Wallace. There's only 5 circuits to go. It's a half-mile bull ring.
Jimmy Hensley is trying to get on the outside. Meanwhile, Jay Sauter has gotten by Jack Sprague. He's trying to take the lead. Oh, and some contact there.
Contact. They're shifting the weight balance back and forth. Look at Wallace getting underneath Sprague. Here's Hensley, this time by 3 laps to go.
And this is really hurting Sprague in the points battle because he's lost 1, 2, 3 spots. Meanwhile, here's Sauter for the lead.
Remember, Sprague never, never pitted. Here comes Sauter underneath Mike Bliss. He's got no tires left. This time by, 2 laps to go. Jay Sauter could set some history here at Louisville. Started 7th. Nobody's ever won this race from further back than 6th.
And Mike Wallace trying to get on the inside of Bliss for the second spot. Bliss is very, very loose. Sprague is trying to fall. Here's the 90, the 43 trucks there as well. This is the battle for second.
White flag is out. It's Jay Sauter's race. The battle really is for second. Look out. There goes some contact. Bliss gets turned around. Will this bring out the yellow? No, checkered flag is going to fly. So it'll be Jay Sauter with the victory. Second place is going to be Mike Wallace. Third to Jimmy Hensley. Fourth to Kevin Harvick.
And you have some trucks coming off the corner spinning.
That is the 52 of Scott Hansen. Look at the crew down at the number 3 pit, the GM Goodrich Chevrolet pit. Biffle finally makes it across the finish line. That truck is torn up. He's got more damage to the right rear. There is Jay Sauter. First win of the year. Last time he won was Martinsville last season. And I do believe he's going to burn up a few tires.
I do believe he is. Where is he? Somewhere in that smoke.
He had 2 seconds at Texas and Michigan. Now he's got a win. Let's go to Dave Burns.
And Todd Barrier had to, as I heard over on the radio, to do a little talking with the 24 truck there. Jack Sprague gave you guys a break to let you go after Bliss, did they not?
Yeah, he worked with us. You know, we need to win a race. He needs to win a championship. We was going to do whatever it took with his help or without it. I tell you, Jay just did a great job driving the thing all night. We elected to come in there a little bit late and thinking it was the wrong thing to do after the fact. But we need the tires to win. We came here to win, and that's all we got to do the rest of this year.
All right, guys, that's how it gets done here in NASCAR. Amy, what's going on with you?
Hey, I'm in victory lane, and Jay Sauter and the entire Goodrich Chevrolet team is just ecstatic. He gets drenched with the cooler by Kurt Bowman. His spotter and tire carrier leaps into the team. This has been a great night for Jay Sauter. Jay, I know the truck was a little loose at the beginning. You thought you had right front fender damage. It was one thing out of another. You were not going to give up at the end. You gave it your all. Congratulations, Jay.
Well, I tell you what, these Goodrich boys were awesome tonight. I was worried, you know, we stayed out. Truck was a little loose. Truck just came to us, you know, and we just kept running hard and got her to the front.
Did you ever think starting 7th that you could pass here at Louisville, such a truck, tough little bull ring, and get up front?
Tell you what, it's my kind of race, and I love it here. This is an awesome racetrack.
All right, well, we're going to let them celebrate. They're all really excited down here. Jay Sauter, obviously very emotional and very excited for his first win this year in the Truck Series.
Is that a baseball bat he's getting ready to take a swing with?
Louisville Slugger. This is the home of probably the trophy.
Well, what an efficient look. Take a look at this run one more time. Sauter's well ahead of this. Look at what goes on, and look at the contact there. Sprague and the 99.
And Mike Bliss, and Bliss goes around, and guess who he's going to hit? All the trucks get by except this one. His teammate, Biffle, comes along and tears up what's left of that Granger Ford.
Marty, some fans may poo-poo the move between the two crews, the 3 and the 24, to make a deal at the end of the race. But the 24 truck of Jack Sprague knew that Jay Sauter was coming through and coming fast. And the only thing that Jay wanted to do was win. Points mean nothing to Jay at this point in the season. Points mean everything to Jack Sprague. And Sprague ends up the point leader tonight by letting Jay Sauter by. So in my book, it's a great move for those guys to work together. It was still a fantastic race.
Well, my final thought, Dave, is a little bit more general. In general, I mean, I grew up at short track racing, and I absolutely love it. I promised you at the beginning of the race that there would be tough racing and that there would be a lot of excitement, and Louisville once again proved to be a very exciting race. I had a great time, as I know the viewers at home enjoyed watching this race. It was great.
EP, final thoughts on your end?
Well, I just, you know, the 43 truck, it's just a doggone shame when you run that good and don't walk away with a victory, but they just waited a little bit too long to make that pit stop. They were going to go all the way, and then when they decided they had to pit, it was just simply too far into the race. About 30, 40 laps, they pit 30, 40 laps before the fact, and I think Jimmy Hensley wins the race.
So we told you when we started this campaign, oh, way back at the beginning of the season, that these guys could play rough, and especially on the short tracks. If you had a weak stomach, don't get involved in the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series, and never more evident tonight. We tied our record for 12. Gang, you have done a great job. That you don't miss a trick. It's been our pleasure to work with you, and we look forward to it again. For Benny Parsons, Dave Burns, Amy East, I am Marty Reed. Sports Century is coming up next. We'll see you next time that we go truck racing, round 24 of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series, 8:30 next Friday night from Texas Motor Speedway. So long, everybody.